following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
It is. It is. And we're here. Welcome to a Wednesday. I'm Nicole Sandler, and oh my goodness, things go from crazy to totally insane. So I filled up my What's News segment this morning with 6 minutes plus of news, and then all hell broke loose because there's a lot of stuff going on. So let me tell you a couple of things that happened today. Oh, hold on. I've got the wrong sheet up here. Hold on. That's the wrong one. Today's 9/9, not 9/8, right? It is September 9th, and there is news going on. So let me tell you about the first big breaking news story, and this is the biggie. Robert Woodward, Bob Woodward of Watergate fame, All the President's Men fame, has a new book coming out. It's called Rage. It'll be out on Tuesday. Tuesday's the day they release new books. And, well, he's making waves because now we're in the week leading up to it. You would think that today all the news would be about Michael Cohen's book, who made some pretty stunning allegations last night, both on The Rachel Maddow Show and on NBC Nightly News with Lester Holt. But Michael Cohen has been upstaged today by Bob Woodward because, well, 6 days out from the release of the book, he's releasing segments, and lordy, there are tapes. Yes, Donald Trump actually sat for 18 interviews with Woodward, which were recorded with Trump's permission. You see, Donald Trump, I think the technical term for it is a star fucker. You know, the more famous people are, the more he sucks up to them. So Bob Woodward, of course, he's one of this generation's great journalists, even if he isn't really, because of Watergate, because of All the President's Men. And so I guess in Donald Trump's eyes, that makes him terrific. Anyway, so Woodward released some of the tapes of some of these conversations to CNN, who released some of them. And one of the big revelations was that Donald Trump knew very early on just how serious the coronavirus was. So here on January 28th, National Security Advisor Robert O'Brien gave him a jarring warning about the virus, telling Trump it would be the biggest national security threat of his presidency. And just a week later, in one of his calls with Bob Woodward, Trump was honest with him. He wasn't honest with us, but this is what he said to Bob Woodward at the time.
And so what was President Xi saying yesterday?
Well, we were talking mostly about the virus, and I think he's going to have it in good shape, but, you know, it's a very tricky situation. It goes through air, Bob. That's always tougher than the touch. You know, the touch, you don't have to touch things, right?
What?
But the air, you just breathe the air, and that's how it's passed. And so that's a very tricky one. That's a very delicate one. It's also more deadly than your strenuous flus. You know, people don't realize we lose 25,000, 30,000 people a year here. Who would ever think that, right?
I know.
It's pretty amazing. And then I say, well, is that the same thing? This is more deadly. This is 5 per, you know, this is 5% versus 1% and less than 1%. You know, so this is deadly stuff.
This is deadly stuff. He knew it. That was February on March 19th, as Trump was still telling us, oh, it's just going to go away. It's just going to fade out. Don't worry about it. On March 19th, he again spoke with Bob Woodward when Woodward asked him, why are you downplaying the severity of the situation here?
Now it's turning out it's not just old people, Bob. Just today and yesterday, some startling facts came out. It's not just old.
Yeah, exactly.
Young people, to plenty of young people.
So, give me a moment of talking to somebody, going through this with Fauci or somebody who kind of it caused a pivot in your mind, because it's clear just from what's on the public record that you went through a pivot on this to, oh my God, the gravity is
but he never did.
Inexplicable.
No,
and unexplainable.
He never did that,
well,
Bob.
Really, to be honest with you.
Sure, I want you
to be honest with you.
I wanted to always play it down. I still like playing it down.
Yes, sir.
Because I don't want to create a panic.
He played it down because he doesn't want to create a panic. That's what Donald Trump said to Bob Woodward on the record in an interview on March 19th. So today, Kayleigh McEnany had a press briefing in the White House briefing room. She was asked about Donald Trump's less than honest assessment in talking to the American people, because we know if he had alerted the public to the seriousness of this, then maybe people would have taken it seriously and worn masks and socially distanced and, you know, saved perhaps a few lives. So here's what happened today in the briefing room. I'm going to play for you how it happened on CNN, because I want you to hear what her name is Brianna Keeler, what she did when she finally cut in to this propaganda session. This is what happened today.
How can a president bear no responsibility for the almost 200,000 lives lost when he downplayed the virus initially and he knew that how contagious and deadly it was? I don't understand how that can...
The president never downplayed the virus. The president expressed calm. The president was serious about this when Democrats were pursuing their sham impeachment. He was expressing calm, and he was taking early action, and his actions are reflective of how seriously he took COVID.
The tact that he took, the language that he used.
No.
You said that he used hopeful language. Does he regret that, given where we are now?
No, this president embodied the American spirit, that when we face a challenge, a crisis, a pandemic, we come together. We can be optimistic. We can be serious about it. We can take it seriously with our actions, which is exactly what this president does.
What?
It's why we lead the world in testing.
I'm
doing far more than the number two, which is India. He took this seriously, but he still expressed calm.
Wow.
Our food supply chains were at risk. We could not have mass runs on grocery stores. The markets, also the economy was in play here. We didn't want there to be a huge crash and panic. He expressed calmness from this podium, but he has always taken it seriously, and the response, an unprecedented response, really reflects that.
Really?
Yes.
Really? Okay, so she goes to another question, and this happens.
AstraZeneca trial. So does that throw a spanner in the works that they've halted those trials in terms of getting a vaccine?
All right.
That was a press secretary at the White House lying.
Lying!
She said the president never downplayed the coronavirus.
Lying!
This is what the president said at the time.
Yes. What did he say at the time?
And again, when you have 15 people, and the 15 within a couple of days is going to be down to close to zero, that's a pretty good job we've done.
It's going to disappear. One day it's like a miracle.
It's
going to
disappear.
Yes. And from our shores, it could get worse before it gets better.
God.
It could maybe go away. We'll see what happens.
Stay calm. It will go away. You know it is going away. And it will go away. And we're going to have a great victory.
Kayleigh McEnany lying about how the president described the coronavirus in early days, proving just how concerned the White House, how concerned the president is about these revelations from this upcoming book by Bob Woodward.
Wow. 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 So that's where we are. So Donald Trump spoke on the record 18 times with Bob Woodward. Apparently, if what I'm reading is correct, his staff didn't even know it. Again, because he's a star fucker. you know, Bob Woodward, ooh, he's famous. He's a big name. I'll talk to him. Did he not read Fear, the first Bob Woodward book of the Trump administration? I don't know. But yeah, he did. He did all that. there's, you know, our friends at the Midas Touch, they're nothing if not talented and fast. I want to play for you their newest video, their newest spot that just went live within the last hour or so, and see if you recognize a familiar voice in here. Just saying. Anyway, here it is. It's called Pretender President. Take it away, Midas Touch. Trump pretended the coronavirus wouldn't come to our shores.
I wanted to always play it down. I still like playing it down.
The risk to the American people remains very low.
He pretended the Democrats were overreacting.
And this is their new hope.
He pretended it would go away.
A lot of people think that goes away in April with the heat.
And then he pretended again.
It's also more deadly than your, you know, your even your strenuous flus.
View this the same as the flu.
And again.
At some point, that's going to sort of just disappear.
And again.
It's going away now. It'll go away.
While Trump pretended, Americans faced real consequences. Nearly 200,000 dead and rising. Businesses closed. And now, as over 1,000 Americans die each day, what's the Trump administration's plan? Pretend that the pandemic is over. In a time of crisis, Americans can't afford to have a pretend president.
I wanted to always play it down.
Midas Touch is responsible for the content of this advertising. Good stuff, right? And yeah, if that voice sounded familiar, I do voiceover work on the side. And when the Midas Touch guys were on the show, I offered my services. So we actually recorded that. We recorded that a couple of weeks ago, and I was wondering where it's been, but it's been a nonstop news cycle, right? So I get an email today from Brett Masala saying, you know, because of the news cycle, obviously this one keeps getting pushed to the side, but with the breaking news from today, we're in it. But I needed to change one line because in the original script, I read something like, 180,000 Americans dead and rising. Had to change that to almost 200,000 Americans dead and rising. But, you know, have studio will travel. So there you go. The new one from Midas Touch. Feel free to share it and get it out there. By the way, Joe Biden spoke today, a thing that was televised, and he weighed in on this news.
On the day that we hit 190,000 dead in the United States because of COVID-19, we just learned from the Washington Post columnist Bob Woodward that the President of the United States has admitted on tape in February he knew about COVID-19, that it passed through the air. He knew how deadly it was. It was much more deadly than the flu. He knew and purposely played it down. Worse, he lied to the American people. He knowingly and willingly lied about the threat it posed to the country for months. He had the information. He knew how dangerous it was. And while this deadly disease ripped through our nation, he failed to do his job on purpose. It was a life and death betrayal of the American people. Experts say that if he had acted just 1 week sooner,
yep,
36,000 people would have been saved.
Yep.
If he acted 2 weeks sooner, back in March, 54,000 lives,
yeah,
would have been spared in March and April alone. You know, his failure has not only cost lives, it sent our economy in a tailspin. It cost millions more in American livelihoods. This is a recession created by Donald Trump's negligence, and he is unfit for this job as a consequence of it. How many schools aren't open right now? How many kids are starting the new school year the same way they ended the last one, at home? How many parents feel abandoned and overwhelmed? How many frontline workers are exhausted and pushed to their limits? And how many families are missing loved ones,
yeah,
at their dinner table tonight because of his failures? It's beyond despicable.
It is.
It's a dereliction of duty. It's a disgrace.
It is a disgrace. It is a disgrace.
Come on, man.
Come on, man. It is a disgrace. And so good on Joe Biden for calling him out. You know, people have been asking, why did Bob Woodward sit on this? Well, he was writing a book. But there's that question of, I don't know, of journalistic responsibility. In this case, he's writing a book. He's a responsibility of the publisher and responsibility to the American people. We are at almost 200,000 dead Americans. And Bob Woodward knew back in January that Donald Trump knew the severity of this. He knew that it was airborne transmittal of this virus that could kill you. He knew that it affected everybody, not just the old people, despite the bullshit that he doled out to the public or anyone who would listen to one of those ridiculous propaganda sessions that he would hold in the White House briefing room. I don't know. But as Joe Biden points out, there a lot of lives could have been saved if this information had been released sooner. Just saying. There was other breaking news today. And there's more on this. I've got so many notes on this Woodward book, but we've got plenty of time to talk about it as we go forward. The other big story, though, has to do with a new whistleblower. A whistleblower inside the Department of Homeland Security who said that top Trump appointees, at the agency, repeatedly sought to censor or stop reports on Russian influence activities in the U.S. In other words, them, interfering in our elections and worse. So the guy who filed this whistleblower report is Brian Murphy. He served as the Office of Intelligence and Analysis Undersecretary inside the Department of Homeland Security. It was a 24-page complaint. He filed it yesterday, alleging that he was instructed to halt the assessments because they were, quote, making the president look bad. Seriously. Among other concerns raised in the complaint, Ken Cuccinelli, who is an acting somebody at the DHS, who, by the way, there is a complaint filed against both him and the acting Homeland Security Secretary, Chad Wolf, because they're both unqualified for the positions they now hold. Donald Trump has said he's going to nominate Chad Wolf to be the permanent Homeland Security Secretary, meaning he'll have to be confirmed by the Senate, something that I don't think would happen, because it was Chad Wolf who told Murphy, according to this complaint, that an intelligence notification regarding Russian disinformation efforts should be held because it was unflattering to Trump, who had long derided Russian interference as a hoax that was concocted by his opponents to delegitimize his win in 2016. Wow. So Murphy alleges that 2 months earlier, Wolf told him to stop producing intelligence assessments on Russia and shift the focus on election interference to China and Iran. He said that Wolf told him, quote, that these instructions specifically originated from White House National Security Advisor Robert O'Brien. Murphy said he wouldn't comply with the instructions, which he believed would put the country in substantial and specific danger, according to the complaint. And again, it was filed yesterday with the Department of Homeland Security Inspector General. But there's another part of the complaint that in it, I mentioned Cuccinelli, in the, another concern in this complaint that Cuccinelli ordered Murphy to downplay intelligence about white supremacy to make the threat appear less severe and play up evidence of left-wing violence. In fact, there's another story out today that that when I read it, I'm not sure where I read this, maybe over at CNN or Politico. They didn't make it clear that this emanated from this whistleblower complaint, but this other story tells us that there are three draft documents within the Department of Homeland Security the most recent of which predicts that white supremacists will remain the most persistent and legal threat in the United States through 2021. Three draft reports were made public by Lawfare editor Benjamin Wittes and first reported by Politico, and they assess a whole host of threats, including cyber, foreign influence, and irregular migration. All three of these drafts state that white supremacists are the deadliest threat to our nation. Not Antifa, which doesn't exist as an organization, or any other Black Lives Matter. They don't come into play. It's all white supremacists, and the Trump administration just keeps playing it down. It is astounding and just mind-blowing. We knew this stuff already, right? But now it's out. And I'm hoping we're going to see these three draft documents that the DHS never released, obviously, because they didn't have the findings that they wanted to promote. It is just absolutely stunning. Will it make a difference? Your guess is as good as mine. All right, so coming up today, we've got a great guest for you. I mentioned the other day, as I was looking through my little constitution, for where it said that Congress is charged with oversight of the executive branch, that there's a system of checks and balances in our three branches of government, or allegedly co-equal branches of government. So, and I couldn't find it. So that's why I was really excited when I saw this new book. And the book is called OMG, WTF, Does the Constitution Actually Say? Wait, hold on. No, I pick it up. I had it on the floor over there. It is a non-boring guide to how our democracy is supposed to work by a guy named Ben Sheehan, who does it with a real sense of humor because he's a creative, funny guy who actually used to work at Funny or Die. But this book is really good. So we'll talk about, oh my God, what the fuck does the Constitution actually say in just a little bit. But you know what? I haven't played a funny yet. And there's a new one from our friends at the Parody Project, Don Karen. I don't really know the song that they're parodying here, although you know the genre and you'll pick it up really quickly. Take it away, Don Karen and the Parody Project.
In 2020, a trip we all did take to show off our megaplex upon a Texas lake. We took a lot of flagpoles and we took a lot of flags, and we took a lot of burgers that we stuffed into our bags. We packed our guns just in case we met some liberals. We packed some booze just in case they didn't show. We packed some books just to show we're educated. Don't ask what they're about, we cannot read, so we don't know. They told us we could come although we didn't have a yacht. They said the more the merrier, though merry we are not. We said we are defenders of the cross and of the gun, and your right to do most anything as long as it ain't fun. We packed our guns just in case we met some liberals. We packed some booze just in case they didn't show. We packed some maps that would show us how to get home, but none of them got pictures, so we don't know where to go. We sat low in the water cause the flag they pulled us down, and we prayed to Mother Mary that there were no yachts around. Till one came speeding by a churning up a big old wave, we sank with not a single mega flag that we could save. We packed our guns just in case we met some liberals. We packed some booze just in case they did the show. We packed some drones cause the Taliban of Texas might be lurking near the rocks, so yeah, you'd never really know. Yeah, we brought our boats along and we sat them in the water, and we started out a sailing where another wouldn't go. Weighted down so heavy that a boat could never save us. If we spilled a cup of coffee to the bottom, we would go. Yeah, we got real wet when our boat went down below, and we cried real hard when our flags we couldn't show. It was a plot by Nancy and that nasty fella Joe. We heard it on Breitbart and that is all we gotta know. We packed our guns just in case we met some liberals. We packed some booze just in case they didn't show. We donned the MAGA hats cause they make us feel like generals. We were getting ready to put on a killer show. Yeah, we brought our boats along and we sat them in the water, and we started out a sailing where another wouldn't go. Weighted down so heavy that a pump could never save
because if we spilled a cup of coffee to the bottom, we would go.
The Progressive Voices Network.
All right, we're back. And I've been told it's the Battle of New Orleans. I should have known that. That's what song they were parodying. And in case you didn't see the video, yes, I'll post it on the blog today at NicoleSandler.com/9-9-20. That's today's date. And it had to do with the little boating accident that the Trumpers had last week. And so that's what that was about. Kind of funny. Yeah. All right. There's so much more news today, but again, I invite you to go to NicoleSandler.com, click on What's News, and you'll hear today's What's Newscast, or just stay tuned on the Progressive Voices Network, because chances are it'll play at the top of the hour at 6 Eastern, or not. It plays occasionally at the top of the hour. Anyway, let's get some Constitution talk in now, shall we? Again, this is a book that I was pretty impressed with. So let's get Ben Sheehan on the line. Okay. Joining us on the line now is Ben Sheehan. He's the author of a new book, and it's a different book than anything I've read before. It's called OMG WTF, Does the Constitution Actually Say? It's a non-boring guide to how our democracy is supposed to work. Ben, I love this book. This is really a great resource.
Well, thank you so much.
What made you decide to write this, to put this together?
So during my political work in 2018, the organization I started, OMG WTF, and during 2018, it stood for Ohio, Michigan, Georgia, Wisconsin, Texas, and Florida. And we were helping governors, secretaries of state, and attorneys general in a partisan fashion. But I noticed that a lot of events that we would have, people would come up to me and go, is this person running against Rex Tillerson? Is this person debating Jeff Sessions? Oh, yeah. And it slowly dawned on me they didn't know that their state had a Secretary of State or an Attorney General, let alone what that person did. So I started looking at civic education and what schools require or states require. And I found out that only 8 states today require a year of civics or government education, K-12. And this is much different than how it used to be. In the 50s and 60s, we had classes like U.S. government and American history and foundations of democracy and civics. And today, we've drastically shrunk that. So people aren't getting civic education and government education like they used to. And obviously, this is pretty important stuff. So I thought maybe I would start with the founding document and sort of explain this, which clearly says how our federal government is intended to work, and a lot of state governments as well, and go from there.
Wow. And you're absolutely right. I mean, I remember, I'm actually originally from New York, where schools were much better than they were here in Florida. I don't know if they still are, but when I was growing up, that was the case. I went to eighth grade here in South Florida, and I still remember my eighth grade civics class because I really loved it. I found it fascinating. And then my daughter was going through middle school and high school, and I was waiting every year for her to have a civics class, and it never came. She never had a civics class. And so, you know, I did my part, I hope, in trying to explain to her, but I was mortified that we don't teach how our government works to kids these days. It's just, it's a real oversight. So now this book, I love what the OMG WTF stands for. I hadn't realized that. But it works on a few different levels, doesn't it? And this is actually an adult book. This is not a book for kids, though high schoolers would probably appreciate the language in it.
Yeah. And the intent was, you know, since 2002, especially. So in 2002, you had No Child Left Behind. In 2010, Common Core. In 2015, Every Student Succeeds. These were all a mix of federal and state policies that really decimated civic education by focusing on reading and math. And if you talk to a lot of teachers, public school teachers, they will tell you this, that suddenly the priority, because funding was tied to it, is reading and math over and over again in these states, added standardized testing. So, you know, that's kind of why we are where we are here today. But I wanted to write this for the generations that have graduated high school that didn't get that civics requirement in the last 20 years because of these policies, so that they had something that would help bring them up to speed. But like an adult talking to an adult, not necessarily for kids, right. Although there is a kids book coming out next year.
That's what you say. So without the F-bombs, which there are a number of them through here, and as one who uses language to its great effect, I appreciate them because it's the way we talk, you know. So when I see you commenting like what the fuck about something, it's like, okay, he's talking my language here. So what you do, Ben Sheehan, in this book is go through the Constitution, basically give it the print it in the language in which it was written, and then translate it into, you know, 21st century vernacular so we can all understand it, and then give a bit of explanation of what each section is about. And that's helpful because it is not necessarily very, 21st century friendly to you know, ears who don't know the language of the 1700s very well.
Yeah, it's not at all. And in fact, the grammar is bizarre. The punctuation is odd. The spelling is strange. It's very inaccessible.
And you also give us a historical perspective. So, for instance, this Constitution has been around, 230 some odd years now. This is the longest lasting Constitution in the world?
That's true. It's the oldest Constitution that is still in effect today.
Wow. That's wild, because we're a relatively young country. And to hear some of the originalists talk about the Constitution is like, this was how it was written. This is how it's to be interpreted. This is as it is. And there are others who believe it is a living, breathing document, or it should be, because we've changed a whole lot in the last 230 some odd years, right? What do you think? Should it be living, breathing?
I mean, it's less what I think. It's more that it was designed to be living and breathing.
Right.
I mean, the entirety of Article 5 is about the amendment process. And when this subject comes up, I think about a conversation over letter between James Madison and Thomas Jefferson in 1789, shortly after the Constitution went into effect. And Jefferson argued that he thought the Constitution should be changed every 19 years, because to keep something for longer than that would be like expecting a coat you wore as a child to fit you as a grown man. Things change, laws change, people change, and times change. And so the Constitution should adapt with that. And they very clearly gave us a process with which to amend the Constitution. So anyone who makes the argument that it isn't supposed to be changed clearly didn't read up to Article 5.
Okay, so I guess Scalia, he's rolling over in his grave now, but maybe he should read your book. Do you have a favorite part of the Constitution?
Do I have a favorite part of the Constitution? Yeah. There are definitely things that I didn't know that are extraordinarily strange, or things that I had long thought to be true that aren't.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say one of them is the fact that we don't fundamentally have a right to vote. It's left up to the states, and it nowhere in the Constitution does it say specifically who can and can't vote. It's state legislatures that have the ability to decide voting laws in each state. Congress can make or alter those regulations, but you know, we think that we proactively got voting rights for African Americans with the 15th Amendment or women with the 19th. It actually doesn't say that. It says that if you have those rights, if you're a citizen and you have those rights, you can't have your voting rights taken away because of those things. But it doesn't proactively grant it. And there were a number of states that allowed women to vote long before 1920, when the 19th Amendment was ratified, Wyoming being the first in 1890. Wow. Six states in the 1790s allowed free African Americans to vote. They soon changed those laws. But, you know, we think of these amendments as proactively giving us the right to vote, and that's not actually the case. Another thing I found really strange is that you don't have to be a representative to be the Speaker of the House.
Right.
You don't have to be a senator to be a Senate President pro tempore. You don't have to have any qualifications whatsoever for those jobs or to be on the Supreme Court.
Isn't that wild? Yeah, I guess to be on the Supreme Court, you don't even have to be a lawyer.
You don't. I mean, Elena Kagan was never a judge before she was on the Supreme Court. And I mean, you just have to have a pulse, a good relationship with the president and friends in the Senate.
I guess so. We're speaking with Ben Sheehan about his new book, OMG, WTF, Does the Constitution Actually Say? A non-boring guide to how our democracy is supposed to work. So I've read the Constitution a number of times. I have a bunch of them. So if any listener needs a copy, send me an email. I'll send you one. I've have them from years ago. And, in the last few weeks, as we have watched Congress attempt to perform its oversight duties, I just always believed that it's in the Constitution that Congress has the responsibility, constitutionally mandated, of oversight of the executive branch. And the system of checks and balances, I always thought, was written into the Constitution. But as I've watched the this administration ignore congressional subpoenas, and then I saw a ruling the other day from the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals that said, yes, Congress can subpoena documents. In this case, they were talking about Don McGahn, the former White House counsel. There's no law that states that he has to comply. And obviously, I'm paraphrasing here the way I understood it. Basically saying that Congress can pass a law to compel them to comply with the subpoena, but it doesn't actually exist. And I'm like, that can't be right. So I opened up my little trusty pocket constitution here and went to Article 1, which talks about the powers of Congress. And I read through it very carefully, and nowhere did I see it spelled out that Congress has the responsibility and duties of oversight. Is it in the Constitution?
Well, yes and no. It's not specifically in the Constitution, but as you bring up, Congress is Article 1. And this is something that I think about a lot, because I think we're taught the branches of government in an incorrect way. Not a wrong way, but in an incomplete way. And what I mean by that is we're taught that we have three co-equal branches of government, right? The legislative, the executive, and the judicial, and they have checks and balances. So, yes, they have checks and balances, but they're not co-equal branches of government. And if you look in the Constitution, as you mentioned in Article 1, it's very clear that Congress is supposed to run the show. The most amount of power that's specifically enumerated in the document is for Congress. Congress has the ability to remove a president. A president doesn't have the ability to remove Congress. And so for things like, in the original debate, they talked about maladministration, but, Congress can impeach and remove a president for, treason, bribery, and high crimes and misdemeanors. And what that means is high crimes and high misdemeanors. So it doesn't have to be criminal for that person to be removed. They could be doing things like abuse of power, which was considered a high misdemeanor. So they put in this provision that allowed Congress to remove a corrupt president for some criminal activity and for other criminal activity or non-criminal activity, I should say. But as far as subpoenas, the only time that ever comes up is in the Bill of Rights, where you can compel witnesses to testify on your behalf. But to your point, yeah, it's not specifically in the Constitution for Congress.
So why did I always think it was? Why do we say that this is one of the prime responsibilities of Congress, is its oversight capability and responsibility?
Well, because the president, in a way, works for Congress, and Congress is working for us. And the way that this was designed makes a lot of sense when you think about what it was designed in response to, comparing it to the monarchy that a lot of these people left to come over and start this country. It was one person who had absolute power and kept that power in the bloodline and passed it on.
Right.
This was a complete response to that. It was people by voting, and obviously there are some caveats to voting, but people by voting had the power to elect representatives who would then govern on their behalf. And that included being able to hold the president accountable. So it is very much, a Congress-led document. And the truth is that there are some very strange things that are in there for Congress to be able to do, and there are some not strange things. But I think it just goes to show that a lot of things we just assume to be guardrails and provisions in our document are really just norms.
Right. So then I guess on a technicality, the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals was right. There is nothing that says that you have to comply with a congressional subpoena. Yet, history tells us that for the most part, public figures have through the years. Until now, Donald Trump, and there may have been some where they'd fight them, they'd go to court, but I don't recall, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm certainly not a historian, I don't recall any, administration officials, employees, members, ever just ignoring congressional subpoenas before in the past, as they're doing now. In fact, right now, the new Postmaster General, Louis DeJoy, is actively not turning over the materials that he was asked to produce when he testified under oath before the House Oversight Committee on August 24th. He was supposed to produce these documents by the end of the week. Now it's 2 weeks later, and they're talking about subpoenaing him. But they'll hit the same brick wall that they got, I guess, with the Don McGahn subpoenas. If there's no mechanism to enforce the subpoenas, why even bother? And does Congress have any powers of oversight at all?
Well, we're getting into more of the legal weeds of things that are not in the Constitution. But, you know, again, about the impeachment process, this was not just something that was set up for presidents. This is for all government officials, not for members of Congress. They have their own ability to remove people, you know, with a 2/3 vote. But this was the mechanism where if somebody in the executive branch is abusing their power, abusing the public trust, or committing crimes, it's up to Congress to remove them. And I think one of the things the founders didn't really foresee, because political parties didn't exist when the Constitution was written.
Not in the Constitution,
Right. It would be 4 years before they started to take hold halfway through George Washington's first term, but I don't think they could have predicted that Congress would just not be able to agree on anything, being constant partisan lockstep. I don't think they foresaw the amount of influence that private corporations would have on our Congress. And so this was something that they thought would be the mechanism to remove people who are abusing the public trust in the executive branch. But if we're not using that mechanism, then, you know, we're kind of stuck.
I guess. So the book, you go through, as you know, you would expect, the Constitution section by section. And Article 1 is, as we discussed, about Congress. Article 2 is about the executive branch and the presidency. And I've heard Donald Trump say that Article 2 of the Constitution gives him all kinds of powers, basically dictatorial powers, that I don't see anywhere in here. I do see limits on the presidential power in Article 2. Do you think, after listening to Donald Trump, that he's ever actually read it?
I haven't seen anything to indicate that he has. When he says things like it gives the president absolute power to do anything, that's obviously not true.
Exactly.
It goes against the very thing that, you know, helped prompt starting this government in the first place. There are certain powers of the presidency that are absolute, things like the pardon power for federal crimes. The president has the ability to convene Congress during an emergency. Both houses or either house. There are a couple of things like that, but the vast majority of presidential powers involve, you know, congressional approval or at least Senate approval, from everything from treaties to law. I mean, the president can't pass a law. In fact, Congress can pass laws without the president with a 2/3 vote in both chambers. So no, that's not true. The president does not have absolute authority. The one place where it does get a little bit up in the air is when the president is the commander in chief of the army and the navy and the militia when it's called into service. And so it doesn't specify what those powers are. So anytime you see sort of this stretching of executive power, it's often done under the, you know, role of being commander in chief, because it doesn't go into a lot of specificity of what that entails.
You know, you mentioned two things there. One is you mentioned militias, and the other, talking obviously about the powers that a president, or that Trump thinks he has. So let's talk about executive orders. He issues a lot of them after, of course, criticizing the previous president for doing the same thing, certainly though Obama didn't do it to the extent that Trump does. But an executive order is nowhere in the Constitution, is it?
No, it's not. An executive order is something that the president can issue to enforce an existing law. And it has been done a lot by past presidents, too. Teddy Roosevelt issued a shit ton mm-hmm. of executive orders. Same thing with FDR.
Yep.
But, you know, when you have, again, it gets back to sort of like the executive orders, in my view, are a symptom of the problem. The problem being that Congress is not doing its job, and specifically one branch of Congress, the Senate, I don't believe, is doing its job in terms of holding enough hearings about bills, things that are coming out of the House. And so it's the gridlock, and the partisanship is just the Congress is stuck and not working. It's like a clogged drain. And so executive orders are kind of like a way to irrigate around it. But, you know, again, it's only to enforce an existing law, and the next president can overturn them. So, you know, the executive order power is not in the Constitution.
No. There's a lot of stuff that's not in the Constitution. And then there are questions about how we interpret what is in the Constitution. You mentioned militia, and according to the book, you say militia is mentioned twice in the Constitution. One I know of course, is the Second Amendment, which is possibly one of the most misunderstood and misconstrued amendments. But then again, we don't really know because we can't talk to the people who wrote it. When I read this, I say, the Second Amendment is very short and sweet. A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. To me, that doesn't say that 17-year-old Kyle Rittenhouse can take an AR-15 across state lines from Illinois into Wisconsin and shoot three people, killing two of them, because he's part of the militia. That's not what this is. To me, the way I interpret it, and if I were on the Supreme Court, the way I would interpret the Second Amendment is the National Guard. That's what the well-regulated militia is, the National Guard. But that's not the way Heller saw it the last time the Supreme Court took up the Second Amendment. So what do you think is in the Second Amendment? What does it say?
Well, I think it's pretty clear to me, and it's also pretty clear to 200 years of Supreme Court justices. You know, as you mentioned, Heller, the District of Columbia versus Heller in 2008, that's the first time that the Supreme Court said we have an individual right. Yeah. Unconnected, not because we're a member of a militia, not because we're eligible for a militia, but totally separate from a militia, a fundamental right to have arms for self-defense. And in that case, it was talking about a handgun. But this is something that wasn't really a debate for a long time because it was pretty clear, and it does mention the militia two times in the seven articles, and both times it talks about Congress being able to establish training for the militia, being able to regulate, arm the militia. So it's clear congressional oversight of the militia and the rules and structure and supplies and funding. And you know, in the early 1900s, it was the National Guard that became established as like the main militia. But the point I think is really important to understand is that they're talking about the like a U.S. militia, mm-hmm. a federal militia, right? Reserve troops, the National Guard and reserves for the Army and the Navy. It isn't somebody just to come up with an idea to have a militia. Now, state laws are different. If it's a, you know, state defense forces or state militias, it depends on the state, but they're definitely not talking about somebody just like deciding to start a Facebook group and get a militia together and arm themselves. That's not what the Second Amendment is referring to.
Right. Yet there's a lot of people who think it is. And frankly, you know, it's one of the things I'm most frightened about should Donald Trump, well, either lose or appear to win. I have a feeling come November 4th, things are going to get decidedly uglier than they already are in this country. And, you know, it doesn't escape me that a lot of the people who own the guns are on the other side. And we have no protect. I mean, just looking at what happened over the last few weeks, I mentioned Wisconsin in Kenosha, where this 17-year-old shot three people, killing two of them, injuring horribly a third, and the police seem to just ignore him, let him walk by, even thank him for being there to have their backs, and yet other people who may be a little darker toned in their skin, are rounded up and arrested. There's something seriously wrong here, and this is something that is not addressed in the Constitution at all. We got a lot of things. In fact, Ben Sheehan, I was impressed. At the very end, you have some thoughts, and you do a whole section on what's not addressed in the Constitution. What do you think are the biggest omissions? What's not addressed in there?
Well, there's a huge omission. Again, you know, the fact that the there's this sense that the Constitution only applies to citizens, and that's not true. There are certain things that apply to citizens. You have to be a U.S. citizen to hold federal office, and you don't have to be, obviously, you don't have to be born here to be a member of Congress. But the rights and protections of the Constitution aren't exclusive to United States citizens. And getting back to what I was talking about earlier with voting, for a long time in this country, non-citizens voted in federal elections, in state elections. And today, in my home state of Maryland, non-citizens can vote in local elections. In a few local elections in California, non-citizens can also vote. It's only been since 1924 when Arkansas became the last state to outlaw non-citizens from voting in federal and state elections. But and then there's a law in the 90s that reiterated that and upheld that, which is the first time at the federal level that happened. But you know, people could vote who were not citizens for a long time if they, you know, they paid taxes and they voted. The filibuster is not in there. That's a Senate tactic that is fairly recent about a century, and it's a way to, you know, obstruct the will of the people now that the Senate is democratically elected by us rather than by our state legislatures. You know, the majority leader of each party, the minority leader, these roles aren't in the Constitution. So there's a ton that we sort of come to think of as the jobs that really have the power in our government that are nowhere to be found in our founding document.
Yeah, and as we said earlier, political parties aren't even in the Constitution. We have them. I'm wondering, is there anything in here that could protect us? And I should back up a second and say that this book, OMG, WTF, Does the Constitution Actually Say, is nonpartisan. It's a fact-based book. This is the Constitution. Here's what's in it. This is the 2020 interpretation of what those words mean. But you don't really you do editorialize, but not from a partisan viewpoint. Going on your history, Ben, you come from a comedy and creative background. You were with Funny or Die for a long time. You produced a lot of really funny videos. You worked with, who was the group you worked with after Funny or Die?
I worked for Joss Whedon, the director writer, right. And I ran a super PAC that he started called Save the Day, where we made about 20 videos in an effort to get young people to register to vote in the 2016 election cycle. Right. We were able to register 50,000 people just off of videos.
So that's what I was having a brain fart on. He put out some very creative stuff. So this is kind of a leap for you, isn't it? I mean, how do you go from the creative world? I guess writing a book is creative, and this take on the Constitution certainly is a creative way to look at it. But is this just always been your interest?
It has, and I, you know, don't hold it against me, but I grew up in Washington, D.C. I was born in D.C., and I had a family members who worked in government, including the federal government. And so, you know, I got that one government class in eighth grade. In fact, it was discovering my eighth grade pocket constitution that I was lucky my school gave to me that helped, was one of the impeti for writing this book. But I've always been around government and got an education from it from a parent who worked in the federal government and studied it in school. And even when I was at Funny or Die, I was doing a lot of videos that were helping to explain issues and parts of government. We did a video where Waka Flocka Flame, a popular rapper, announced his candidacy for Speaker of the House because of these non-requirements in the Constitution. So it's always been something that I've been interested in. And I think it's because I had great teachers who happened to be my parents. And so I wanted to take that and take my experience creating comedy and entertaining content and use it to explain something that I think is the most important thing that we could know as residents of the United States.
You know, they say you can't, when something's not broke, don't try to fix it. And not that it needs improving, because Schoolhouse Rock was pretty awesome. This is from when I was a kid. But, you know, you're younger. You're one of the, what, the 35 under 30 or something of great people coming up and creative and all that. So good for you.
Something like that, yeah.
I'm from the generation before. We had Schoolhouse Rock. There's nothing like that for today's kids. Would that be a project that you might think about taking on with a comedic bent, something fun and funny and that grabs kids and teaches them about our government?
Well, there's something I'm working on right now that I can't get into details on, but that is very much along those lines, although it's more for an adult audience, kind of like this book, and the people in their 20s and 30s and 40s. I've heard rumors of shows that may be coming out soon that are specifically teaching civics to kids. And I think what's really interesting is that so many of us talk about Schoolhouse Rock, and I watched Schoolhouse Rock when I was in school, but it was really about three videos that were government education from Schoolhouse Rock, and they were all in the 1970s, mid-70s. Yes. So we're talking about education from, you know, over 40 years
ago
that is still being used. I think it's long overdue
for
an update.
I think so, too. You'd be a great candidate for that, so maybe we're thinking along the same lines. And the question that I was going to ask you that I qualified by saying this is not a partisan book by any means. Is there anything in the Constitution that protects us from someone like Donald Trump? Because I see him trampling all over the Constitution, using the Attorney General as his personal attorney. Now, I mean, in the news today, that he's taken on the Justice Department to defend him against the allegation. Well, it's not defending him against the allegation of rape, but the charges, E. Jean Carroll, who's suing him for defamation because he called her a liar when she said he raped her back in the 70s. But it's not only that. It's the total upending of norms. It's the using the White House as a political backdrop for his campaign. Things like that. Things that maybe are not written in the Constitution, but that have never been done because the presidents we've had before know that you don't go there. He doesn't. So there's nothing to protect us against this kind of behavior, is there?
There are two things to protect us against this kind of behavior. Okay. One is obviously impeachment and removal, and two is the fourth section of the 25th Amendment, which was, by the way, written in the wake of the Kennedy assassination, and the idea was that if the president was left incapacitated, but not deceased, how could that person be removed from office? And so the process is absolutely wild. I encourage people to read the book and see what it actually says, because I couldn't make up something as complicated and strange of a process if I tried. But basically, the vice president and a majority of cabinet members or of some other body that Congress could create has to initiate a removal process by telling the Speaker of the House and the Senate President pro tempore that this person is unable to do the job. Then the president has a chance to respond, and it's this back and forth. And ultimately, you know, if it gets to it, Congress decides. But those are the only two mechanisms in the Constitution to remove a president. Now, Justice Department officials in recently and as far back as the 70s have put together memos saying, well, a sitting president can be tried and held, you know, criminally tried for crimes while in office. They can't. Ken Starr released a memo saying that they could. So there is this debate among legal scholars about whether or not the president is immune from prosecution or not. But, you know, it's never been tested because we had, you know, one president impeached in the 1800s, a second president and third president impeached in the last few decades. And Nixon resigned before he was impeached. Right. So we've never had a sitting, you know, criminal trial in the legal system for a president.
Right. And I should mention the attorney general can be impeached, and in this case probably should be. But that's, we're getting into another possible book here. Ben Sheehan, it is fascinating and just shows, you know, even though this is all in writing, it's still open to interpretation. And right now we're kind of screwed because it all depends on the makeup of the Congress. As you point out, Congress is both houses, the House of Representatives and the Senate. Even though most of us use Congress talking about the House, it's actually a bicameral Congress. There's two houses. So just a ton of great information in this book, presented in a really entertaining, fun way, and the way that we talk. So I like at the end you have sort of a here we got it down, and you sum it up, if I can find it. Of course, I didn't bookmark it, but something like here, if you didn't have time to read all that, fuck off. So you're a man after my own heart, because that's sort of what I would say. The book is OMG, WTF, Does the Constitution Actually Say? A Non-Boring Guide to How Our Democracy is Supposed to Work. Ben Sheehan, thank you for writing this. This is a great resource, and I recommend it to everyone. I appreciate you coming on today.
Thank you so much, Nicole. It's been a pleasure talking with you.
For me too. Thanks. And with that, we come to the end of another program. Ben Sheehan, you can find him on Twitter at That Ben Sheehan, Sheehan. And we're done. I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks for listening, everyone. Take good care. Be safe. Bye. Don't listen to Trump. He lies.